So we're going to do a bit of an introduction, which is why mental health, just to think about why this is such an important topic for us to think about. Then we're going to look at the dominant models of mental health that exist within the society that we're in. We're going to focus particularly on psychiatry, because that is the kind of dominant model that affects the way that most people's experience of mental health and mental health services kind of works and runs. And then I'm going to go on to talk about Marxism and the mind, talk about why capitalism is bad for us, and then talk about why treatment within capitalism is so limited and what the difficulties with that are and with that is, and why there are some of the reasons for how we can change things. I'm also going to talk a little bit about self-agency and service user movements, because I think that's a really important part of how we combine the people who work in services, the people who use services, the people who have experiences of mental health difficulties might actually be those people in services and people using services at the same time. I don't think we should polarise those identities, but there are some complexities to how that works. And I'm going to talk about mental health and struggle, because I think that's also a key part of the Marxist analysis. How do we change it? And actually, if you think about the really, really key insights, I think John Parrington was saying this earlier, the key breakthroughs in terms of science have often happened when the level of class struggles have been really, really high. And I think it's important to actually kind of recognise that that's true in psychology and in our approaches to working with mental health and psychological distress as well. So hopefully, it's a bit of a whistle stop to all of those things, but hopefully it won't go too fast for you. Right. So why mental health? In any given year, a quarter of the US and UK populations will have some kind of mental health problem. There's over 1 million people in the UK off work due to diagnosable psychological distress. 10% of children have a mental health problem at any one time. And the number of people in the USA who are so disabled by psychiatric difficulties that they qualify for government aid has doubled over the last couple of decades. The statistics go on and on and on. The depressed mood is actually the most common mental health issue in poor countries and the second biggest in wealthier nations. And it's a class issue really as well. There are more serious pessimistic diagnoses for working class service users. So if you're somebody who's middle class, you're much more likely to get a diagnosis of bipolar disorder than you are to get a diagnosis of, and I'm using inverted commas for those of you that can't see, of schizophrenia. I think some of the terms and some of the language that's used need thinking about. Personally, I think psychosis is a much better term than talking about schizophrenia, but we can debate that if people feel that that's something they'd like to talk about. People with mental health issues are the only group with a major major illness, in inverted commas again, with declining life expectancy. So this is a massive issue for our class, it affects all of us. The other key issue, just by way of introduction, is that there's now increasing evidence, really, that austerity and reduced well-being are linked. So mental health problems are associated with low income and socioeconomic status in all developed nations. There's been a rise in antidepressant medications. Now, this is something that's quite complex and we need to kind of unpick a little bit. There are a couple of factors here. There was a rise in distress and people seeking medical treatment for that distress. But there is also what some people have called the iatrogenic epidemic, which is associated with drug companies and other kind of agents, so big pharma, trying to make money out of people's distress as well. So it's not just as simple as looking at the rise in statistics. We have to think about how they're collated and other factors that might be driving that as well. But I'll come on to talk about DSM-5, which is the psychiatrist's bible, basically, the diagnostic and statistical manuscripts, in a little bit when we talk about psychiatry. GPs are reporting increasing numbers of mental health appointments. There's been a rise in male suicides. Really interesting study in The Lancet, which is a really, really well kind of respected and recognised journal. Suicides have increased in European countries with austerity policies. So UK, Greece, Spain and Portugal, but not in those which have protected their welfare states, including Iceland and Germany. So there's something about trying to understand why it is that countries that pursued austerity are experiencing a rise in psychological distress. I'll come on to that. A lot of this information is taken from Psychologists Against Austerity briefing paper, which is well worth a look. You can find that online. The job centre. Why would that be relevant to a meeting on mental health? Well, as a lot of people will know, basically the government have decided that they're going to try and escalate improving access to psychological therapy scheme to be, so some of those sessions that they're proposing will be directly held in job centres. So something that was quite implicit in Layard's New Deal under the Labour Party, where they kind of said that actually there's a link between psychological distress and unemployment. So what we're going to do is we're going to train up lots of IAPT therapists, and they can go out and with 6 sessions of CBT, everybody will be cured of all their psychological distress. So they're rolling that out, and that's going to be directly provided by job centres. And it's part of the... you know, there's been resistance to this. What's heartening to hear is that actually a group of people from the anti-austerity psychologists group actually went down to Stratton Job Centre and being protested about that. So there's opposition forming. But you know, you only need to kind of really look at that picture to think that there's something very, very seriously wrong with the way that mental health is being responded to and thought about in our society and by the Tories. Did mental health difficulties start with capitalism? I think we have to argue that although our experience of mental health difficulties is profoundly shaped by the society that we're in, actually, you know, it isn't true that there weren't difficulties in terms of psychological well-being before capitalism. So, for example, and the models were very, very different. So Hippocrates would talk about humoral imbalances, so people's phlegm, were they more sanguine, differences in the blood. Whilst the kind of Christian church was dominant, people would talk about possession, supernatural forces. Within feudalism, the central question was, can the person take care of themselves? And there were kind of old distinctions between, inverted commas, idiots and lunatics, so people that were unwell and people that were unable to kind of to think things through. And as Roddy kind of outlined in his meeting, I think, around disability, a lot of this it starts to kind of... it's happening before capitalism kind of develops, but actually kind of really starts to take shape with the Industrial Revolution. So this is a picture of one of these early asylums, and there's a quote here which talks about it was never the rich who filled the big asylums. So with the development of the Age of Reason, the Industrial Revolution, you start to see large groups of people being kind of put into asylums, either because you're poor, but basically it's about your ability to work, it's about your relationship to that. To that capacity to work, so people. But it was actually usually working class people that were put into that kind of situation. What you also see at that time is a move much more to the application of science to the experience of psychological distress. So the kind of medical view of madness, not of humanity, starts to develop at around this time, and there's a move away from those kind of humoral imbalance, kind of demonic possession explanations. So the asylums has existed beforehand, but within capitalism, there's a shift towards treating the insane poor according to, inverted commas, the principles of moral treatment. And from the beginning, it was a really important class element. So, small rights. The Age of Reason, mercantilism, and enlightened absolutism coincided with a new and rigorous spatial orientation. It put all forms of unreason under lock and key. Beggars and vagabonds, those without property, jobs or trades, criminals, political gadflies, couldn't read that then, and heretics, prostitutes, libertines, syphilitics, alcoholics, lunatics, idiots and eccentrics, but also rejected wives, deflowered daughters and spendthrift sons were thus rendered harmless and virtually invisible. So this move of people away from their communities into these large institutions. Later on in this period, it becomes much more medicalised with the rise of psychiatry. So by the mid-19th century, the insane, in verticals again, were clearly and sharply distinguished from other problem populations. They found themselves incarcerated in specialised, bureaucratically organised, state-supported asylum systems, isolating them both physically and symbolically from the larger society. And at that point in time, you've got this kind of emerging science of medicine, which sees an opportunity, really, within the asylums, to kind of capture the madhouses that were previously run by laymen, ready-made and captive clientele. And actually the word psychiatry is quite interesting because it actually describes the medical treatment of the soul, which is quite an interesting word when you think about what it means today. Actually, moving on. In terms of the main models of mental health, we're going to talk a little bit about three of them. And starting, obviously, with psychiatry, really. So Dave Pilgrim talks about three different families of theory for explaining mental health and psychological distress. So at the top you've got the psychiatric model, you've got the psychoanalytic model here with Freud, and the psychological model featuring Skinner, really, who's one of the fathers of behaviourism as an example of that approach. all of these models are very profoundly shaped by capitalism and by the way that we think about categories, none more so than psychiatry. This is a little diagram that basically tells you how mainstream psychiatry thinks about psychological distress. So let's imagine that you've been feeling under the weather, you go to your GP, you say that you've been having difficulties with sleeping, you've been having difficulties with eating, you've gone off your food, you've stopped enjoying things that you usually like, you're bursting into tears all the time. So your doctor will look at this manual here, or we'll have that kind of internalised, and will be starting to think about your difficulties and perhaps viewing them as symptoms of depression. They'll then make their diagnosis, and they might prescribe you either antidepressant medication, or less rarely now actually, refer you for talking treatment. So this is the biomedical model. It views mental illness as a disease. It's highly influenced by genetics and biological determinism. And this book, DSM-5, like its predecessors, tries to group together psychological difficulties to classify, diagnose, and ultimately treat the underlying mental illness. And the role of psychiatry is to kind of do that process of categorisation. So psychiatry fundamentally understands unusual or distressing psychological phenomena as symptoms of an underlying biological disease. So that's the main kind of the way that people will get kind of responded to. People might want to come on to talk about DSM-5 in the discussion because it has been extremely controversial. The difficulties with this model is that, as Maloney argues, it's like arguing that headaches come from a lack of aspirin. There's a lot of reverse kind of thinking involved in this. So psychiatric theory emphasises that mental health difficulties are caused by chemical imbalances, and it's a faulty reasoning which works back from the treatment to the cause. So basically, the three major classes of drug, so looking at anxiety, psychosis and depression, were developed in the 1950s from anaesthetics, infection and allergy treatments. And it was claimed, and they were used to treat people with mental health difficulties, and because they worked, they then inferred backwards that these must be the underlying chemical imbalances that exist. So it's a kind of faulty logic. However, just because that's happening doesn't mean that there's no role for biology in the way that our psychological distress occurs for us. So a lot of the issues with this medical model are the drugs. So there's some really interesting writers, people like Joanna Moncrief, who's a psychiatrist, who's basically arguing for actually better medication for people that doesn't have debilitating side effects, and that isn't like trying to use a sledgehammer to crack a nut, basically. There's a lot more kind of targeted. So she would argue things like the drugs which alter neurotransmitters don't create psychological disturbance, we know that. There's no evidence that any class of psychiatric drugs acts by reversing or partially reversing an underlying physical process. We know that diagnosis is unreliable. If you ask two doctors to diagnose the same psychological distress, they may not agree, and they're much less likely to agree than they would if they were diagnosing skin, kidney or heart complaints. Some of the symptoms that are listed under each diagnosis don't cluster together reliably, so people don't always kind of put them together. And as Richard Bentall, who's a kind of prominent professor in psychology, says, these definitions were drawn up by psychiatric committees in smoke-filled rooms, so they're psychiatric folklore institutionalised by committee. So there's a lot of issues with how DSM was developed, how it's maintained. It's big business for the American Psychological Association. It makes them thousands and thousands of pounds. So there's something about how we engage with that. But fundamentally, there's this faulty line of logic back from the chemicals to the cause, which really doesn't work, and I think we reject. Psychiatric diagnoses are often also presented as kind of really as scientific and historical truths. But what I want to argue is they're really profoundly affected by the dominant values of the capitalist class. So, for example, drapetomania was something that was kind of coined many years ago by Cartwright in 1850, which was a disease causing Negroes to run away from slavery and owners. So the idea was, it never caught on, actually. But it was widely circulated, but criticised by his contemporaries. And you can think of other examples. So homosexuality wasn't declassified as a psychiatric disease until 1992, which is shocking, really, when you kind of think about the dateline there. And actually, thinking back to the idea of struggle and how important struggle is, It was partly the Gay and Lesbian Foundation who kind of campaigned for that, and managed to get that revoked earlier, and then the ripple effects meant that it then got removed from all of the psychiatric classifications. And psychiatry's approach to women is quite interesting. I mean, women are often treated as the kind of special case, whereas actually they're the normal form of psychiatric patient. Women tend to receive more invasive treatments. And the classic example again would be the diagnosis of hysteria. So women in the 19th century could be locked up for marrying the wrong man, having children out of wedlock. They'd be diagnosed as hysterics and given hysterectomies. Hysteria meaning literally wandering uterus, and earlier kind of forms of treatment were attempts to lure the uterus back to its rightful place using kind of scents and things. It's not objective, is what I'm trying to say. If you think about psychiatric treatments, obviously there's a horrific history, really, of really invasive treatments. So psychosurgery, lobotomies, lacutomies, ECT, which is a lot more widely practiced than a lot of people kind of realise. About 11,000 people a year receive ECT in England, more than twice as many women as men were given it. Nearly half of that is given to people over the age of 65, and a systematic review found that at least a third of the people who took part reported permanent memory loss. So really interesting stuff, actually. John Reed and colleagues challenged a research study which was being proposed by Manchester University, and managed to get it revoked, I think, but it was all over the papers and stuff, but basically saying that this, they'd applied for ethics to try and get a study on ECT kind of conducted, comparing ECT and ketamine, I think, as treatments for depression. So that's horse tranquilizers and electric shock therapy as a treatment for depression. And they were, I think, fairly successful in challenging that and saying that actually there's a very limited evidence base for ECT. And there's some really, really, really interesting research that says that what ECT does is used as a treatment of last resort quite often, and they've argued that what it actually does is it makes the psychiatrist feel better, that they're doing something. That's a very crude summary of a paper by Richard Bentall and colleagues, but that's fundamentally what seems to be happening there. A lot of psychiatric treatment has also been eugenically informed, and we've talked about the asylums as well. One of the great kind of shocks, really, to psychiatric treatment comes from quite an unusual place, really. So up until, so bearing in mind this kind of idea that that people thought that it was the poor, the insane, the unable who were in the asylums, the dominant theories up until this point in time, earlier on last century, are really that those things were all associated together eugenically and it's all in our genes. There are two kind of big challenges to this. So once the Great Depression happens, actually people realise that lots of people can experience depression. And the other thing that kind of really changes the way that people think about psychiatric treatment and who can experience psychological difficulties is that when officers, the gentlemen came back from the war having experienced shell shock, actually that people realised that it wasn't, that anybody could experience these things if they were placed under enough trauma and distress. So that had quite profound implications, really, for the way that psychiatric treatment happens. Moving on slightly to think about psychology, there's an excellent book by Paul Maloney where he talks about the psychological therapies industry. And he argues that there are a number of problems with psychological therapies. I mean, don't misconstrue me here. It is a good thing that there is more access to psychological therapies, but it needs to be good psychological therapies, and we need not to pretend that that's the sole answer for everything that's happening, really. I'm reminded of a conversation I had with a young comrade whilst we were on a demonstration once, and it was when I was thinking about whether to go into psychology or not, and I said, should I be doing this? Or he was somebody who'd experienced some mental health difficulties. And he was saying, if I go to services, I want people like you to be there to talk to me so that I feel well enough to be able to go out and change things. So it's about kind of avoiding a kind of polarisation there. However, the therapy industry kind of presents the idea that everything could be solved by by, in caricature, a few sessions of CBT, and that we can fix people's faulty reasoning. And then kind of let people go back into their social situations, and that actually they'll be able to maintain some of the changes that they've maybe managed to make in individual sessions. Maloney argues that this professionalises responses to distress. It distracts from the idea that suffering is social, And it relies on the idea that people actually have the resources to bring to make those changes at that point in time, which may just not be true. You know, it may just not be true at that point in time. So the idea that the therapy is going to solve everything is something that I think we need to kind of reject as well. Right. The Midland Psychology Group argue that distress is not an illness and so cannot be cured. It's not bad genes, faulty cognitions, or the Oedipus complex, but misfortune and the widespread abuse of power that mire so many in madness, addiction, or despair. These are not symptoms of illness, they are states of being that encapsulate how most of us might respond to chronic adversity. So it's about thinking, actually, often it's a human response to distress. In terms of the symptoms like psychosis, actually, if you put any of us in the desert without food and water and enough stress, we would all start to hallucinate. Our bodies allow for that to kind of happen. However, we want to think about the kind of society that we're in that puts people in those kinds of situations of extreme distress, trauma, that would create those sort of things, those sorts of experiences happening to people. So the Midland Psychology Group talk about, this is their manifesto. So fundamentally, this is where I think we've got to be really, really careful. We're both social and material beings. So we're part of the social world, but we also have a body. You know, we're physically, genuinely here. And distress arises from the outside inwards. Distress is produced by social and material influences, and trauma is really important in thinking about understanding psychological distress. Distress is enabled by biology, but not caused by it. So what we feel has physical consequences, but it's not necessarily the cause, although there's obviously a debate about that. And I think our understanding of genetics is so kind of minimal, really, in terms of some of the impacts of genes and genetics, that we're not sure what role that can have. But I think we need to allow for there being a biological basis to our thoughts and feelings. And it's about thinking at different levels. Distress doesn't fall into discrete categories or diagnoses. Our behaviour can't be separated from our context. And medication and therapy can make a difference, but not by curing. They're a sticking plaster, really. Either of them are a sticking plaster. And good therapy is about relationships and resources, not about techniques. So it's about meeting with somebody who can give you some hope that the world can be different, that can help you to understand your psychological distress and help you to put meaning to that. That's what good therapy is about. It's not about learning a series of techniques to kind of cure your faulty cognitions, really. What did Marx say about the mind? Marx said, it's not the consciousness of men that determines their existence, but their social existence that determines their consciousness. So it's the world that we're in that shapes the ways that we think, and that gives rise to the dangerous, nasty, difficult world that we're in is the thing that means that we experience threat, anxiety, and low moods, you know, that fundamentally. He also says, if happiness is a state of mind, then it's arguably dependent on one's material circumstances. Happiness or well-being is an institutional affair. It demands the kind of political and social conditions in which you're free to exercise your creative powers. And we're going to come back to that in a bit, because towards the end we'll just talk about what Marx... I think, again, Roddy really emphasised this in his meeting on disability, but there's something about... Marxism's about liberation, and actually, that, you know, there's something, a sense in which we can't really truly be liberated in the society that we're in. How do we go about finding that kind of change in which we can actually really truly be ourselves? Marxism offers a number of key concepts, really, for thinking about mental health. But before that, it's worth just talking you through the stuff from Trotsky on the mind-body problem. So, as we've said, the medical model focuses absolutely on the biological. Trotsky has a different take on this, and this is about really having a dialectical understanding of the relationship between the mind and the body. So he's trying to respond to the issues around Cartesian dualism, the idea that how do we integrate these two things. So he talks about a method of psychoanalysis, taking as its point of departure the autonomy of psychological phenomena, in no way contradicts materialism. Quite on the contrary, it's precisely dialectical materialism that prompts us to the idea that the psyche could not even be formed unless it played an autonomous, that is, within certain limits, an independent role in the life of the individual and the species. So as a species, we have evolved to have complex minds which give us the ability to react back on our physical bodies. That's something that's very unique to us as a species. And Trotsky also says, at some sort of critical point, there is a break in the gradualness, a transition from quantity to quality, the psyche arising from matter is freed from the determinism of matter, so it can, by its own laws, influence matter. So it's that idea that man makes history, but not in circumstances of his own choosing, really. We're in the world that we're in, but our psyches can make choices, but they can also react back. So, for example, you know, we might have drives towards hunger, but we can decide to go on a hunger strike as a protest and deny that kind of physical drive. There's lots of other examples of that. Marx said very little directly about mental health. What he did comment on is some of the stuff about the asylums, and he talked about what had gone on over in Ireland. So he does talk about the notion of insanity as being underpinned by capitalism, and he also understood the class nature of admissions to hospitals. So what he's describing here is he's talking about Ireland, and he's saying, if it's so good, why are people flocking over to England, and also why are so many people being admitted to the hospitals, to the asylums? So he doesn't comment directly, but he does seem to have that sense that actually there is a class nature to the admissions. The reference to Jonathan Swift is that Jonathan Swift left his whole fortune to building a lunatic asylum in Dublin, which was opened in 1757, and Marx is making the point that actually before this industrialisation, you couldn't actually find enough people to kind of go into that. So he says very little directly, but there's some comments there. So let's have a think about why capitalism is bad for us. People talk about, I think, the cause of the causes. So if you think about, in thinking about psychological distress and mental health, you have to think about some intervening variables. There are some steps in between that we kind of have to think about. So capitalism drives all of the things that drive all of the difficulties, really. So capitalism creates poverty for most people, it intensifies exploitation, it creates inequality, alienation, oppression, war and terror. So we're clear about that, those are the things that it does. We're just going to spend a little bit of time, the remaining bit of the meeting, thinking about how it does that for various different areas. Psychologists Against Austerity have talked about the austerity ailments. So these are things that they think are kind of key responses, really, to what's happening with austerity in this country, and the experiences, the emotional experiences that people have as a consequence. So humiliation and shame, fear and distrust, instability and insecurity, isolation and loneliness, and being trapped and feeling powerless, all of those things being kind of responses to some of the things that are being driven through by the Tories. So poverty is associated with reduced mental health. We already know this. The poorest 1/5 of adults have doubled the risk of experiencing mental health issues. Mental health issues 2 to 3 times more common in the poor than in the rich, and the same goes for children as well. Poverty is also associated with low pay, unregulated labour markets, more accidents at work, more bereavement, job losses, violent crime, fewer pleasant events, and crucially less rest. It's also associated with shame and humiliation. There's been studies looking at people's experiences of using food banks, actually, and that's been linked to experiences of shame. And given that shame can be described as the bedrock of psychopathology, so the bedrock of psychological difficulties, it's not difficult to see why, when there's so much blame going on around benefits, that actually people are finding it harder and harder and harder to kind of be resilient in the face of that, really, and experiencing psychological distress. There's also something about a lot of the literature sort of focuses on the psychosocial issues and not so much on the material issues. But there is something about, if you're constantly being defined in society as a consumer rather than a worker, and you've got no ability to consume things, then how does that kind of leave you feeling? And I think Freud is very useful and interesting on that. And it's also worth noting that over half, actually, the UK population who are living in poverty are working households, and that's come from the Joseph Rowntree Foundation. But again, just thinking about what that does to kind of experiences of shame, really. As austerity increases, exploitation intensifies, rates of depression have soared since 2008. Maloney talks about the proletarianisation of working roles. So people are working harder, longer, with less control. There's the impact of the new managerialism, of neoliberalism. We've got fewer rights, worse conditions. People in all sorts of sectors talk about the impact of targets, performance appraisal, increased monitoring and surveillance, longer hours, low contractual security. Is it any wonder, really, that we're suffering with the anxiety in response to all of this? I think not. But the literature backs that up. So job insecurity leads to poorer mental health outcomes, whatever your occupation is. People have lower levels of autonomy in low status jobs. And living in poverty reduces agency generally. People on low incomes and passive jobs tend to experience more external what's called locus of control, so a sense that things can't change from you, they happen to you. And even in jobs like teaching, actually, suicide rates have risen by 80% over the last decade. 66% of people with mental health difficulties thought workplace stress was a factor. So actually, whether you're in work or whether you're out of work, capitalism's creating problems for all of us, either around your relationship to work. So we basically talked about this, so And people will be familiar with the spirit level hypothesis, so that's the idea that there's inequalities, and that inequalities, so this is the graph looking at the prevalence of mental illness. So the more unequal a society is, irrespective of the actual levels of income, the more psychological distress is experienced by people. And that comes back to this theme of shame and humiliation. So how, you know, a lot of that's about how do you compare yourself to the people around you? How are you left feeling in the world next to the people that are around you? We talked about the antidotes to this as well, but the thing with the spirit level is that it kind of presents the inequalities as though they're just a kind of fact. And Navarro argues it's not the inequalities that kill people, it's the people that are responsible for the inequalities that kill people. And that's the bit about the kind of class analysis and going a bit of a step further than Wilkinson and Pickett. You know, there are people who hold this in place. You know, we have there's a capitalist class who benefit from this, and they're the people that make those things happen. Marx also talks about alienation. So that sense of you go to work, your labour is extracted from you, that sense of being absolutely knackered at the end of the day, you know, that sense that it's been stolen from you, it's been taken away. In capitalism, labour is external to working people. Marx says he doesn't affirm himself but denies himself, he doesn't feel content but unhappy, and he doesn't freely develop his mental and physical energy but mortifies his body and ruins his mind. You know, that I wouldn't imagine that that's a million miles away from most people's experience of daily working life if you have a job. So there's something about Marx's theory of alienation and how that matters. There's also something about oppression. So the Marxist theory of oppression, I think, has a lot to offer us in terms of understanding the different experiences that people might have of mental health. You're much more likely to experience psychological difficulties if you're from black and minority ethnic groups, something like 60% higher for depression. You're much more likely to be diagnosed as having a psychotic disorder, you're much more likely to be admitted to hospital, you're much more likely to be detained, and you're much more likely to be given ECT if you're from a BME group. You could go through similar figures for gay men and lesbians, you could go through similar figures for women actually as well. But that kind of that process of dividing rule actually has quite profound psychological consequences. I'm going to have to really speed up here, I think. But treatment is limited because it's so dominated by neoliberalism and medication. So medication is massively profitable. There's an 18.5% return on sales compared to the average. Banking only does 13.5%. Some of the biggest companies, if you ever look at the Fortune 500, are medical companies. It's a massive market. GPs write up thousands and thousands of pounds of pounds for drugs in mental health. The global market in antipsychotic meds is estimated at about $15 billion a year, and it's an increasing market. So the number of people going on medications is going up, and this sense of there being an iatrogenic epidemic. So Ben Goldacre talks about in the last DSM they invented another diagnosis called. It's something to do with lack of female sexual interest, so women not being interested in sex. And then it allows the drug companies to then prescribe female Viagra for all this difficulty that is in, you know, nothing to do with the fact that you might be exhausted or that actually all the stuff that we've just described about work or not being in work, you know, actually it's a psychiatric diagnosis and they're going to give us a drug for it. So there is something about the way that that's kind of perpetuated. Treatment's also limited because if you think about CBT and the way that it approaches the human mind, it looks at it very much like it's a kind of machine, like it's an artificial intelligence computer. We're only really able to use the kind of metaphors that we have in society to look at what goes on in terms of the mind. I think there are better models actually, but fundamentally, research asks the wrong questions. So 20-odd% of all studies about schizophrenia are concerned with biological causes. 19% look at medications, only 0.9% look at poverty and 0.3% look at child abuse or neglect. We're looking in the wrong places, actually, for some of the answers. And within capitalism, we'll continue to look in the wrong places for the answers because the money won't be available to look at the things that we actually probably could be looking at with more effect. That's a very, very complicated map of the links. You'll notice they have Cameron on there. That's what the links between the drug companies, basically, and private healthcare. People might want to come in on the issue of cuts to service provision. And I think we have to be really clear that we stand in the tradition of Peter Sedgwick and others, who argued that actually we want decent services to be available for people. Then I'm going to move on quite a bit here. Service user movements are obviously hugely important. I think I've talked about a little bit about how the GLF, the Gay Liberation Front, contributed to declassifying homosexuality. Martin Luther King went to talk to the American Psychological Association in the 60s, and he said there are some things that we should always be maladjusted to if we want to be people of goodwill. And he says, we should never adjust ourselves to the economic conditions that take necessities from the many to give luxuries to the few. We should never adjust to the madness of militarism and the self-defeating effects of physical violence. And there comes a time when we must take a stand that isn't safe, politic or popular, but take it because it's right. So there are some things in the world that we have to keep on challenging. Therapy is not the solution to these things. We have to keep challenging it objectively. Capitalism creates massive crisis. It also creates psychological crisis and misery. I think it's amazing, actually, that people show the tenacity and resilience that they do show in the face of all of that. And there's a need, and there's never been a greater need, as activists, as service users, as workers in mental health, to have collective responses to the wounds that society inflicts on all of us. And one in four of us are going to be distressed enough by capitalism at some point to experience, to be diagnosable, whatever the problems of diagnosis are. We want a psychology and a psychiatry that are liberated from capitalism, that are actually able to kind of look at the difficulties that we have. And actually, we really shouldn't underestimate the importance of solidarity and the fact that that can keep hope and connection alive. The sense of fighting, of doing stuff together, is where we kind of come back to that sense of who we are. It's where we can catch a glimpse of what things could be like in a different kind of a world. I think that's tremendously important. We need to fight the stigma of mental illness. We also need to fight against benefit cuts and the discourse of blame around benefit cuts and against service closures. That's the only way, really, that we're going to get a saner, more humane society where all of our psychological well-being can flourish.
Hi, I'm Monica and I'm a social worker in a child and adolescent mental health service in South East London. And I'd like to thank Beth really for her absolutely brilliant discussion, and I was really pleased to sit in this meeting and hear sort of a bit of a different view to some of the views that have come out in some of the other meetings of Marxism, where I kind of was talking to people over Marxism, sort of saying I went into the meeting feeling like I was somebody who helped people and came out feeling like I was someone who oppressed people after some of the other debates, and something had kind of gone wrong somewhere. And I think it's really important that we do have a view around mental health treatments and how they can actually help people. Because if we take the view that the cause is capitalism, and I will go along with that of mental health distress and difficulties in this society, and I will go along with the fact that it shapes how people experience those difficulties, but if we kind of take the view, therefore, there's nothing we can do except change society, and in the meantime, we can do nothing about people's distress, then people remain extremely distressed within the meantime of what we have. And I think what ends up happening is it ends up being an argument where we can't then argue against cuts to services. We can't then argue that, in fact, we should have better services and more access for people with mental health problems. And I'm working in a service at the minute where we have introduced IACT and we have done all the things you're supposed to do according to the government, and yet we're having cuts to our services despite all of that. And I think, you know, if we were to kind of, I think as socialists, if we had the view that all we can do is change the outside world without doing anything in the here and now, then all I'd have to say to the trust and to the commissioners is, yeah, you're right, actually, because we're all a load of rubbish. So what's the point of having us? And actually, I know for a fact, as Beth has explained, that in times of austerity that mental health problems go up, that every single one of those cuts will have an impact on the young people I work with. There will be young people who will not get a service that they are getting today that they won't be able to get in 2 or 3 months' time when the cuts come in. And I think, you know, that we have to actually say that, yes, we want to keep what we have and we want to make it better.
Setting a standard here, I'll try to keep. I'm Jeremy Weinstein from South London. I'm also here with the Mental Health Charter, and we've got some copies of the Charter at the back if people want to see it, want to sign it. Basically, it's shit having mental health issues. It's shit trying to work with people with mental health problems. It's a real tension, and we manage that tension. As the last speaker said, we have to manage on both sides, and also being carers of people with mental health problems. It's really hard, and we just have to acknowledge that and find a way as socialists how we cope with that daily struggle, and to be aware that it is possible to find the that phrase from Leonard Cohen, there's a crack in everything, that's how the light gets in. And we had a mention of the demonstration in Streatham around the job centre, and psychologists against austerity were there, but so were the mental health users, the mental health resistance group, disabled people against the cuts, there were counsellors and psychotherapists, there were social workers, Action Network, a whole range. And mental health, there's also a group called Critical Mental Health Nurses Group, which is trying to get together. So there is, despite the difficulties, the best of times and the worst of times, there are people trying to make a difference. And we as active socialists, as Marxists, have to try to find a way of we can hold that tension and see how we can move beyond that. And we do have some victories. So at Streatham, apologies if people heard me say this yesterday, they have actually, it seems, backed off from introducing IAP to that job centre.
Go on! Yes.
By that demonstration. They will come back and they'll find a different way of doing it, but we do keep them on the run, and that's what we have to do. It's hard, but we're doing it and we have to continue doing it. And if you're interested in Mental Health Charter, it's at the back. Thanks very much.
Please speak at the mic because we're recording the meeting.
Yeah, I wasn't going to speak to that mic. I was just going to add a few things to what you said, really, because which I think is very pertinent. Because I think one of the things you didn't say was the majority of psychiatrists are white, middle-class men, and that the majority of their patients are black, working-class men. So I think that really needed to be added as well. Also, you talked a little bit about the issue of control and, you know, the working classes and the minorities being controlled through a profession that is mostly led by middle-class white men is an issue. Not that I've got anything against men, but it's just it indicates the inequalities, since a lot of the inequalities are against women as well, and this is a service mostly led by male psychiatrists, middle-class male psychiatrists. And I just wondered also, you said you touched on medication and antidepressants, but actually antipsychotics are massively used as a means of controlling people. And actually, if people are seen to be too loud, saying too much, too outspoken, there are those that will use psychiatric medication, liquid cush, as the old chlorpromazine used to be called, Largactil, and there are still drugs out there, antipsychotics, and you still see people that have spoke out with mental health issues walking around, you know, completely drugged up, injected with antipsychotics, and, you know, quieted down by, you know, medical, pharmaceutical means. And also, there's no true indication that these medications, these pharmaceutical medications, might actually work, because they're actually produced by multinational pharmaceutical companies that make a lot of money from actually producing them and selling them at massive costs. Now, I can say I did take a medication as an anesthetizer. I will, but I lost my medication. I dropped it on the way home. I don't take it anymore, but I did. And I went back to my pharmacist and I said, I've lost my medication. Can I have it again, please? And he said, do you realize that box of medication cost for a month cost me £200? And this is what I'm talking about. One box of pills for a month. This is why it's a multinational corporate business. It's nothing to do with health. One packet of medication was £200 for 1 month's supply.
I just want to ask one question first. How many people out there, when they see a politician like Ian Duncan Smith or something, makes you a million times worse, makes your depression worse, makes your anxiety worse? The government has put us on what I would call a permanent oppressive time machine, where we worry all the time about the future, all the time, what's going to happen next, what's going to come round the corner. I would definitely say that my depression and anxiety is down to poverty and the government, definitely in the government. You're in the future, right, when you're worrying about something, when your electricity bill or your sanctions possibly or something like that. And in the past, the past has got to do with, oh, what I've done in the past, it's too late to do anything, I can't do anything, and what's the matter? So you're in the past. If you get to the present, if you're lucky, that's when you're all singled out and where you're with it, you know. That's when you're in what's called normality, I would call it, when you're in the now. So we should all go for the now. And I do not take medication except for physical things. I will say what I take. And I know somebody's going to be very upset when I'm going to say what I take from it. It's cannabis. And I think that is, because it does make me feel, it makes me want to be in the now, and it doesn't work all the time. But I've had years and years and years and years of all that sort of medication. Preferably, it made me worse. It made me like a zombie. So thank you very much.
Can I just say, lots of people have indicated, if I've acknowledged you, I'm going to try and call you in. The shorter people are, the more people who get to speak.
I just wanted to start off with one slight disagreement, actually, because I thought it was a fantastic talk. What I wanted to start with is actually what I've discovered is that if you further back in time you go, I think we're talking about the end of the 18th century, it was believed that only the rich suffered from mental distress, right? The concept of neurasthenia was seen as one that really only fitted rich people, because only they could be sophisticated enough to have mental distress. And poor people were all idiots and incapable of intelligent thoughts, and therefore were incapable of having mental distress. Now that is actually, that's something that I don't have time to talk about or develop, but I will at some point. I wanted to say something about really why I think, first of all, why I think there's possibly more people here than otherwise there might have been. First of all, because Beth did a brilliant meeting last year and lots of people therefore heard about it and wanted to come. There's another reason though, and that is that there's been a debate in a number of meetings already at Marxism, and I want to really try and get to what I think that debate's about. Because you see, it's absolutely true that most mental health problems are caused by capitalism. I think that's absolutely true. Inequality, misery, blah, blah, blah. All right, I'm not not interested in your applause, frankly, and I'll explain why, right? Because, you see, the thing about it is, it's too easy to tell you what you want to hear, frankly, right? The thing about mental health is, it's messy, it's terrible, it means terrible, terrible suffering for people in the here and now. So if you tell them, everything's going to be all right after capitalism and we've got socialism, it ain't much bloody use to you now. So the frankly, the thing therefore is, we have to engage with what is a very complex subject. And it's possible that there may be some biological predisposition in some mental health conditions such as schizophrenia. We frankly don't know, right? But neither should we turn around and say, that's all bollocks, it's all a conspiracy of big pharma, right? And the truth is that there are elements of this argument in the left, there are elements of this argument among what you might have called the anti-psychiatry movement in the 1950s and 1960s. Actually, lots of these people were shocked when the institutions were shut down by Governor Ronald Reagan in California and by the Enoch Powell, the health minister in Britain, who was absolutely a mad neoliberal. And these people closed down the institutions for one simple reason. They wanted to save money. It was nothing about helping people with mental health conditions or promoting any real care in the community. Care in the community, my arse, we do not have care in the community. That's the problem. So we have to bring together mental health users, service providers, people that don't even get to use mental health services because they think they're going to be stigmatised, they think they're going to be treated like shit, and they think that all psychiatrists are the enemy, etc. So we have a problem. We have to engage with these complexities, and we have to fight for bringing together service providers and service users in the here and now to have campaigns that can actually fight to defend the services we have, and not ally ourselves with the people that want to cut our services to ribbons on the basis of what are very ultra-left and crude arguments, frankly, about mental health, while at the same time preserving that whole question of, absolutely, we're all mad as hell, and we want to, what is it again, we're all mad as hell, and we're not going to take it anymore, absolutely. That is exactly all of us, isn't it? We all have oppositional defiance disorder.
Hi, so my name is Grace and I'm 13 and recently I suffered from anorexia and I go to CAMS at the Royal Free and they help me to like get better and like get back on track with my eating and stuff. So there was rumours that they were going to cut like services like CAMS that help people like me and I know loads of people like my friends and everything, they suffer from anorexia, anxiety, depression and if they cut services like that they're not going to get help and that means like they won't do well in like their exams and everything and the government are already wondering why people aren't doing as well as they want in their exams but if they keep cutting services like that people aren't going to do as well because they're going to not be able to concentrate and they need help and it's like I know that it's hard to like ask for help from people and growing up is hard as it is and sometimes it is shit never mind having to worry about disorders like depression and anorexia, so I think that they shouldn't be able to cut things because people actually really do need help from services like that.
Thank you so much for speaking. I was not as brave as you when I was 13 in services, may I tell you. There's something I wanted to talk about briefly. I mentioned it partly in the disability meetings earlier because I was just reading this pledge, the charter, sorry. And it's very interesting, and I saw as well that I looked in the slideshow, it talked about the decriminalisation of homosexuality. It talked about here how people, when they're ethnic minorities, and how women have trouble accessing services. I, of course, have had trouble accessing services being a super female. Where I have not been able to access services as a trans person, yes. Where I've been actively told to leave doctor surgeries because of that, where I have had now currently complaints going against two psychiatrists who want me to have conversion therapy for it and refuse to actually treat me for the mental health reasons that I have been there for. I have had a working mental health diagnosis for a year because I will not take conversion therapy so they won't treat me. But this is never really seen or spoken of, but I know it's very, very large within my own community that we have a very high rates of mental health problems. Outside of the fact that actually being trans is still in the DSM, but that's for reasons I talked about in the disabled meeting, because if it wasn't, we wouldn't be able to get our treatment on the NHS, so that's different. But
So we're already treated as mentally ill, even though we don't feel we are. And then we do often have mental illness on top of that, which is then actively not treated by doctors. And yet, when I just read this, I saw there was never any mention of it. There was a brief mention of homophobia. And although there is problems around many of these things, especially around racism, but I know that especially when I've met LGBT people, especially T people who are from ethnic minorities, they can't even get their first foot in the door, let alone the few steps I've been able to make. So I'm just wondering if there's more we could do around that, and if you know any organisations that are doing more around that.
Yeah, the first point I just wanted to make was about psychiatrists. I'm a mental health social worker, and I work alongside psychiatrists. The majority of psychiatrists that I work with are not white men. The majority of them actually are Asian and black, I would say, and a high proportion of women, which I think says more about the racism that exists in the medical profession, that the status of mental health is for those who can't, you know, or those who can't do other sorts of medicine. But what I want to talk about is that the Tories and the last government talked about no health without mental health and parity of esteem for mental health. In other words, we will treat mental health the same as physical health. I'm an approved mental health professional. I'm one of those people who does assess people and takes them to hospital against their will if I think that is necessary. And over the last 5 years, I've had to increasingly struggle to do that job because we've lost over 2,000 psychiatric beds in this country. If I assess a young person, I assess a young 17-year-old kid who's attempted suicide, who tells them they've got no reasons to live, and I've got one choice, I either let them go to kill themselves, or I detain them in a hospital. If I detain them in a hospital, and I'm talking about in Wakefield, the closest hospital I can take them is Jeddah Royal in Manchester, because it's the closest adolescent psychiatric unit that we can get that person to. Now, this is not ideal. Right, in terms of the nature of the mental health services is not ideal, but you know, it's all we've got. Cancer wards are not ideal. A&E departments are not ideal. Neoliberalism and capitalism destroys, you know, the services that we've had for. But capitalism does have a problem because ideologically it needs to root mental illness in the individual and in the biology. Because if it doesn't root it there, then people will question where does it come from. So it uses medications that debilitate people, that shorten their lives, reduce their ability to work and to function, which is a major problem for them at the moment. And that's why they're punting things like psychological therapies, not because they like us, it's because actually they know themselves that actually the way that they are treating, they're not going to pay for, what we really need. So they use medication. There's a crisis for them. And there's a reason. I'll finish on this point, right? Beth said earlier on. There's a reason why there's lots of people at this meeting. And there's a reason why there's a crisis in psychiatry. It's because there's a crisis in society. There's a crisis of neoliberalism. And people are questioning the system. And when they start to question the system, they start to fight in very, very different ways. And when you fight, you become reconnected with yourself and your species being. So we fight in the here and now to rescue our mental health for the future. Yeah.
Fantastic. Yeah, firstly, thank you very much for the talk today. It's wonderful as a mental health patient to listen to a therapist's point of view and experiences of what's going on also around the Marxist theory. Number one, when I first went to a CBT therapist, I sat across the desk from somebody who was just a little older than me and another working class white female. And she said to me, you know, your mind is like a computer. The more stuff that you put into it, the more shit it spits back out at you. And I thought, wow, that's amazing. And the light bulb went on in my head. A couple of months down the line, when I'd cut myself a few more times and I ended up in front of another CBT therapist, she sat across the desk from me and she went, you know, your mind is like a computer. The more shit you put into it, the more shit it spits back out of you. And it's that bump realisation that they are all singing from the same song sheet, this diagnosis manual and this curriculum. Certain therapies, I can see people shaking their heads. That's my experience with multiple faith. However, also we've had somebody talk about is it sexist to be coming up against mainly men when you're a mental health patient or mainly women? Well, do you know what? I'm a socialist and I don't differentiate between anyone's gender, sexuality, religion, ethnicity, so on. Right? So I can give a flying banana who is opposite me, right? Because I'm there because I need the help and I wanted to access the help. Another thing about ECT, asylums were a lot more recent in existence than some of the young ones than you might even know of. In the 1960s, in the city of Sheffield, my own granny was in an asylum named Middlewood, which was a mental health hospital there in Sheffield, and she was subjected to ECT after displaying mania and psychosis from the loss of a child. And now, I remember her talking about it, and she just said, all she said was, I told them I didn't want it. That's all she ever said about it. Now, if you are a mental health patient, I do need to let you know that you can talk to your therapist and or your GP. There is a form you can actually sign, which means you do not give permission for ECT or other invasive therapies, which you might actually know that is in existence. So if you feel you're likely to get so upset or experience such psychosis that people might have to make a decision for you, you can re-sign that form while you're in a calmer state of mind. So please do see a doctor or therapist and sign that form and pass on the information that paperwork exists, because so many people don't know about it.
Mind up, please.
Cuts to services, job centre, CBT, with your signing up for JSA. Well, if people want to access mental health therapy, then it should be their choice and not anybody else's.
So just before you speak, we're not quite out of time, but we're running out of time. There's a lot of people lobbying me, and where you're there, we're doing what we can.
Okay. My experience of the mental health system is that some certain conditions is a form of punishment. I've been in prison quite a few times, and on the last two occasions, because I was not thrown into the screws, they did what's called nutting off. Basically, they just assigned me to a mental health unit, and that's it, you're there forever. With prison, you know when you're going to get out. The mental health systems, when you're in there, God knows. My experience was basically, when I got there, they said you need medication, and I try to be nice and friendly, so look, justify your decision. He says, no, you don't have to justify anything, you need to get medication. I complained and argued, I was assaulted by 12 nurses, given jacks full of jungle juice, and stuck in an isolation room for a couple of days. Since then, I found out quite a few nasty things about the drugs, I'm on clozapine. I spend most of my time bombed out of my skull, so I take it at night, and maybe by day I can function a little bit. I discovered something quite nasty about clozapine recently. It has something called sudden death syndrome, which kills 96 in every 100,000 people. Now think about it. That means every 1,000 people who takes this is liable to die from this medication, yet they still prescribe it. Yeah? And finally, on ECT, I've been doing a university course, and part of it is doing electronics. Now, when you're in the lab, you have to follow certain rules. So if you're working with, say, 50 volts equipment, you can't fiddle around it if it has more than, say, 10 milliamps. Yeah. ECT, the voltage and the current are much higher. The rules for electronics are there to make you not get heart attacks, yet they're pumping this shit through your brain. Now think about it, it's horrible. One thing I finally began to realise is that for a very, very long time, though capitalism is the cause of mental illness, they don't want to deal with it. They want to shut down everything. For instance, the Maudley Hospital used to have an emergency unit. I know quite a few people who are mentally ill that haven't been there. And since they've been cutting the services, I've seen some friends of mine go from bad to worse. And there's nothing is going to get done about it. All I can say is that we need to change the mental health system.
Yeah.
Because it's not fit for purpose. So.
I just wanted to add
add a quick anecdote. Like on my train on the way here, I'm sure you've all seen the signs, there was a sign that said, you know, they're trying to tackle loneliness, and it was like how all these things why loneliness is really bad, and like no one should have no one to laugh with, and like really emotive language. It had like a picture of someone like sad on their own, and then it said at the bottom, so if you want to do something about this, text this number where you can pay £3, someone will call this person, like people, I guess someone on the list, and to make them feel more like they had someone. And I just, that kind of highlights it for me, like while we're living in a system where there are people that are profiting out of other people being lonely or having mental disorders, that's just mad. Like that highlights the madness of what it's come to, and that really makes me feel motivated about being here and wanting to make change.
I just wanted to pick up on Beth's final point that I thought was really important about the importance of solidarity and hope. I've been a mental health service user for the past probably 25 years, and I identify now as a disabled person under the social model of disability. And if anyone's not familiar with that, I would recommend Roddy Stilorek's pamphlet on it. The reason why I identify that way, I think, is because for me, if we collectivise as people who are perceived to have impairments, then that's the best way that we can fight back. As a member of Disabled People Against Cuts, I think one of the reasons I really enjoy being part of it is because within the DPAC environment, I get a chance to kind of live without my impairments sometimes. I can be effective, I feel respected rather than ashamed of myself, and that's because of the way that we organise within DPAC, and it kind of gives me a glimpse of what I think society could maybe be like one day. But as a socialist, I'm also aware that us self-organising just as a group of disabled people, we're not going to win and create the social change that we need. What we have to do as socialists is unite as part of the working class, and that's why I totally echo Roddy's point about the importance and what Beth said about resisting that polarisation between mental health service users and mental health professionals. We have to find our common ground and we have to unite. And I think that we've sort of similarly tried to try and work with the Job Centre Plus workers through DPAC and the PCS. And I think that the Streatham Job Centre protest was a really good example of people coming together. And I think that that's what, over the coming years, we need a lot more of.
The speaker was looking at me and laughing because she knows I work in a job centre.
Right, I've got three quick points. The lady at the front, you said about all the doctors were...
Not all.
Well,
I
most,
said,
predominantly. It actually depends where you come from, because in Thurrock, they are all Asian.
Yeah.
And mostly men, they are mostly Asian. The second point, the way mental health service users are treated is really poor. Last year, I almost committed suicide. I was 15 minutes from committing suicide because I had my benefits taken away. For 9 months, I was left with no money. Luckily, I had a very generous ex-wife who gave me 100 quid a month to live on. The other point is how the mental health commissioners treat us. I was part of a thing in Essex called MIME, making involvement matter in Essex. For 3 years, we were given £1 million to be trained up to go out and find out all the information that the commissioners wanted to improve services. 95% of that was ignored. We were told most of this stuff was going to go in. We told that to service users that we went round and spoke to. We now look like liars. And the worst thing is, I actually wrote in the last year of the project, I thought this would be good to carry on, make it a service user involvement project. It would have been, after it had been set up, self-funding, would have provided opportunities for work or volunteering for service users, would have been self-financing, and all they said was, oh yeah, good idea, what do you want us to do about it? They wouldn't even give us any money to set up a meeting to see if any other service users wanted to do it.
First one is, I think capitalism generally is bad for your health. You're more likely to get asthma, cancer, heart attacks and all the rest of them. And I think that when you get treated for those physical problems, you're treated under capitalism by people, by pharmaceutical companies who don't make new antibiotics, because any new antibiotic would only be used once, very, very rarely, for the exceptions, and you're not going to make money out of it. So they spend a fortune on anti-arthritic drugs, which you are going to make money on because people are on them for life, even though we've got thousands that work already. And I think the same parallels are true for mental health. Capitalism is bad for your mental health and it makes you ill. And the sort of service and treatment you get is provided under capitalism. So pharmaceutical companies are looking to make the most money and they're looking to make the most cuts as well. And the people who suffer for both physical care and for mental care are the people who are ill. And some of the solutions to it, the people time when we've got best is actually when the public world has got better. So drains, proper sort of houses to live in are the things that gave us good medical, physical health, and are the things that give us good mental health as well, some of those solutions. But when you've got asthma, because you live in a shit world, or when you've got depression or schizophrenia or any of the other distresses that you have because of the shit world you live in, you are entitled to proper treatment and should get the help that you need. And I think denying people that would be a crime. But I also think when we stand and we defend our health service, we do not defend it the way it is. We defend what we want it to be and we fight for it to be better than it is at the moment, where you haven't got... Manchester, and to be honest, if you agree to come into hospital voluntarily, you're not ill enough to need a bed, and therefore you don't get in. It is catch-22 madness, the world that we live in at the moment. If you get sectioned in Manchester, there's a good chance you'll get sent to Darlington or to the south or to some place. It's a good chance you'll get into a private ward. You're likely to be in a ward that's overcrowded with 120 to 140% occupancy, with not enough nurses, not enough room, not enough space. If I was well, I would be ill if they put me in a psychiatric hospital at the moment, and yet they send people who are extremely distressed. And our answer isn't to say close the hospitals down. Our answer is to say let's have the proper facilities that we need, with the proper staff, with the proper space, with the places that you can go that provide the treatment that you want, where people have a say over what happens to them and have more choice. And I think when we fight to defend, whether it's hospitals for general hospitals or psychiatric services, we do it by saying what we're providing is not good enough, but shutting it down they would love. We want more of what actually would work and help people.
This speaker will be the last speaker, I do apologise.
And I've been told to be very, very quick. Just one more thing that I think that we should that needs looking at, particularly under this new vicious Tory government and the vile coalition that preceded them. Over the past few years, there have been lots of changes in licensing and planning laws. So in our local community, which is in a very rich area of London, in Westminster, we live in an extremely poor area where we have 13 hostels, two hostels for people with alcohol and drug issues, and two homeless hostels, which means that we have a very high number of people with support needs in our local area and a very high number of people who are vulnerable. Just recently, 2 weeks ago, we were campaigning our local area to stop the seventh betting shot being put into our local high street within a 100-yard stretch. It was really, really difficult to challenge that legislation because it's a permissive piece of legislation, which means that the councils are duty-bound to agree to pass the legislation under the 2006 Gambling Act. We did end up winning, which is fantastic, but the reason that we did so is because we had some very specialist people working on our campaign who worked with people who are vulnerable. All I'm saying is that under this new government, planning laws are changing, licensing laws are likely to increase. We got rid of the Betfred, or the Betfred won't be there, and in its place is becoming a money shop, which, you know, borrows money and lends money. At a very high rate. All I'm saying is that it's another way in which we need to be vigilant in order to protect vulnerable people and those with mental health problems.
At that, I want again to thank everyone for participating and leave you with Beth.
Thank you, everybody. That's a really, really wide-ranging discussion. There's a lot of kind of points to cover, so I'll try and come back to specific questions. As far as I know, most of the main, someone pointed about conversion therapy, as far as I know, most of the main psychological bodies have signed up to say that they don't think that that's an okay thing to do for people. Do you know what I mean? So,
well, I know it's legal for sexuality, but not for gender.
Okay, but maybe we should get together and think about actually what can be done around that, because there's been, I know the Association of Cognitive Analytic Therapists recently signed up around that to kind of have a more sort of positive stance. But actually, it sounds like we could learn from each other around it and maybe think about what we could do, which is actually, I think, what needs to happen in general. Just in terms of mental health and struggle, one of the things I didn't get to cover in the introduction, and part of the reason that it's so important, I think people have talked about the need to come together and not to polarise mental health workers with people using services or not getting access to services. I think that's phenomenally important. When I go to work, you wouldn't believe some of the hassle that we have at work. I had a day the other week where I'm meant to be an agile worker in my work. That's the expression. Except I've got no mobile phone, I've got no computer, the car that they're giving me to get into my building doesn't work. I can't book rooms because the system's down. And the photocopier wasn't working either. All I wanted to do was go out and see this guy and find out what was going on for him. You know, if you're working in systems at the moment, they're creaking at the seams. They just don't function at all. You know, which is frustrating for the people working in them and really, really frustrating for the people who want to get seen. So it's about looking at that from both perspectives. I think when we come together, we can achieve a tremendous amount. And if you think about that on a big scale, and you think about the ideas that come out of opportunities where there's been really big struggle in terms of psychology. Think about the Russian Revolution. At the Russian Revolution, you get the ideas of Vygotsky. They're profoundly different in terms of the way that of approaching psychological distress. You think about the liberation movements in Algeria, and you get Frantz Fanon and his sort of thinking from a psychiatric perspective about how to do things differently. The student struggles of the 60s, actually, although we have our criticisms of Lang and Satz and the anti-psychiatry stuff, and I think it basically pretends that there's no distress associated with mental health, mental ill health. There were some ideas out of there. Psychiatrica Democratica in Italy as well, again, born on the back of struggle. There's loads of examples. So where we're struggling, we will come up with better solutions. More recent examples, I know that in Liverpool, the Save Our Services campaign, Save the Local Day Centre, that was about service users and staff getting together to stop that from happening. In services, what they'll be telling staff, what they detail staff most of the time is, you can't afford the service users, don't talk to them about it, it's not fair on them, you can't, there's all these attempts to kind of, there's gagging clauses in most people's contracts, there's loads of attempts to kind of divide and rule, and if we allow that to happen, we're not going to get the services that anybody wants to work in or wants to use. Absolutely hugely support and endorse what people were saying about the need to change the services that we work in. They need to be a lot better. There are some examples. If you think about the Soteria project, that's an example of a genuine place of sanctuary, which might actually be a place that you wanted to go to when you were psychologically distressed. But we don't get a chance to do those things because of the drive for profit. And by the way, it will get worse if the NHS is privatised. It will get an awful lot worse. But there's reasons to kind of focus on struggle and to think about how to kind of take that forward. Marx talks about building or becoming who we are. So he talks about in a future society, there will still be bereavement, there will still be death, there will still be bad things that happen sometimes in a future socialist society, but we can come up with solutions for those things between us, and people hopefully won't be dealing with those in loneliness and isolation and in a position of fear. We can't eradicate everything that's wrong with the world or every experience of pain, but what we can do is hugely mitigate our ability to kind of respond to those circumstances. And Marx talks about, in that situation, we can have an association in which the free development of each is the condition of the free development of all. We're together in this. If we stand together, we can, we can fight back cuts. There's loads of examples of successes in that. I'd really urge people to sign the charter. Some of the things that we can campaign on are things like reject the splitting of our class into strivers and survivors, refuse to pathologise unemployment, fight for a social security system that empowers and supports rather than one that punishes. Have services which are based on notions of co-production. So actually, where people get a choice in the kind of service that they get. I think your example about advanced statements around ECT, and quite some of them who were saying that, is a really good example of that, and it's little known, and yes, people can absolutely do that. But actually, imagine being actually given a choice of decent medications that work. I think we need to reject this DSM language, focus on broad explanations of distress, and we need to use ordinary language to talk about what's going on. Dave Harper talks about developing outsight, not insight. So there's something about actually being able to place in the experience of distress in a historical, biologically embodied context. I think we need to acknowledge the history of the service user movement and how they shape services, and we need to acknowledge the difficulties in services as well. We need more accurate and pragmatic understanding of drugs. We need to understand and critique randomised control trials, and we need to fight back. So we need to defend public services. We need co-production, not consumerism, in services. And we absolutely need that solidarity between experts by experience and experts by occupation. We've got the solutions between us, and that's what we need to do, come together to find them. Yeah.